approaching. So it is a joy to be with you. Thank you for being here. We've had a wonderful weekend here at First Church, and I think we're coming to a wonderful conclusion. This morning's worship was just a real blessing on this day of Pentecost. Thank Medena for being such a large part of that to our children and all the choirs. And thank you for sharing in this time. I know a wonderful gift awaits us. We've just been blessed in more ways than we know. So, Ken, thank you again. We will turn one more thing. There are sales of Ken's music. That wonderful sort of CDs behind you in the breezeway that is to my left as we leave this place. So if you feel led to purchase some of Ken's music, there's a wonderful assortment that you'll find there. So, Ken, thank you again.
Thank you. My heart will feel happens when the Spirit gets a hold of us. We talked about this morning. If you were here, we have this wonderful, wonderful witness from our pastor about welcome to the family. Spirit makes friends where once we were strangers. When I was in high school, I didn't have a whole lot of friends because I was the only blind kid in my school. They'd never had a blind kid before, and people thought that blind people couldn't hear. It's true. So people would come up to me and say, so not only was I the only blind kid in my school, I was the only blind, fat, baby-faced classical musician. And that was not a way to win the girls, let me tell you. You didn't walk up to some really hot little cheerleader and say, "Hey, baby, let me seduce you with..."
Yeah.
disturb the peace or ruin the sacred atmosphere. I don't know what I did wrong. But anyway, they were going to suspend me, except that the students had a sit-down strike and decided not to go to class until I got permission to sing my songs in the choir room every single day at lunchtime. Yes! And I want you to know that my program to win friends through rock and roll was so successful, I started high school with one friend, and I graduated with two. And I will tell you about my two friends. One was Jerry, and Jerry was the guy who brought the speakers up. Jerry, in the intelligence area, was about, oh, I don't know, three French fries short of a happy meal. But he had this wonderful bass voice, and those of you who remember early rock and roll know that we loved our basses. Oh, baby, you know, baby. Oh, baby, baby, I you. Oh, baby, baby, come to me, I you.
Kind of like the church, a bunch of weird people.
friends where there was no strangers.
Welcome to
find it, but I forgot to tell you, the next verse of the song was originally intended to accompany the worldwide handshake. So, if you shake hands with 53 people, we can do this right. One, two, three, go hand, come together.
Time to sit.
When Spirit gets a hold of us, the Spirit opens our eyes to see how wide our family is and how inclusive our family is. I think of two boys born in Ethiopia. Their good Christian parents gave them nice biblical names, Samuel and Joshua. And Samuel is a young man who now roams the streets of my city because he's homeless, can't find a job, can't find a way to make a living. His brother Joshua, meanwhile, sits looking over the barren fields in his small Ethiopian village where there has been drought and famine for years. And when I pass Samuel and when I think of Joshua, I think, okay, these are my brothers. What do I owe them as part of my family? What shall I do? How do we bring this together? These brothers of mine, how do I care for them?
Now, my hungry child, to you.
mixing sound, and is also a backup vocalist. Thank you very much. When the Spirit gets a hold of us, Spirit gives us the courage to speak out for the right. You remember all those disciples sitting in that upper room wondering, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? What are we going to do? Our beloved one is gone. Jesus is gone. Now what are we going to do? The whole thing's ruined. He told us to wait here, but what are we going to do? And all of a sudden, on Pentecost Day, the windows fly open, the wind is blowing, there are tongues of fire on everyone's head. And what happens? Peter, oh, Peter, you crazy man, you. Old Peter gets up, opens the door.
Your attention, please!
And he proceeds to tell him just exactly how the cow ate the cabbage. And how Jesus was the Messiah. 3,000 people got converted. That's what the story says. If that's the case, wow. Big whoopee that was. That was a big day. So, Spirit gives us the courage to speak out against injustice, to speak out against the wrong, to speak out for the right. And I can't help saying, in this time in our country, when hate is flying around all over the place, when Congress people have a hard time getting anything done because they can't stand beside each other, because they can't bear to work together, we have got to find some people who dare to speak out for love, who dare to speak out and call this country back to peace and back to cooperation and back to working together. Lord have mercy. It's going to happen in First Methodist Church in Martinsville, Virginia. Anyway, the Jews have a wonderful feast that celebrates people who dare to speak out. It's called the Feast of Purim. And they celebrate Queen Esther. Remember Queen Esther? Oh. So the Jews are in captivity. They are slaves. And one of the things that happens here is that the king has got to have new girls for the harem all the time. So the representatives from the palace are walking down the city street and they're looking at all the young girls and they see this young Jewish girl, this young slave girl.
Hey, look, look at the Hebrew chick over there. Man, she is, well, you would say she's a hottie. You know, if you bring her to the palace, present her to the king, woo, the rounding points we would get.
So they kidnap her. And they bring her to the palace. Now the story calls her Queen Esther, but she really isn't quite a queen. She's one of many wives and subject to all the jealousy and all the difficulty that happens when you have many wives in the family. And one night Esther is in her chamber and she hears a knock on the window. And she looks out the window and there's her cousin, Mordecai. What? Baby, how did you get in? How did you even get past security? Look, you've got to leave here because you're going to get killed if they see you here. Mordecai says, Esther, you've got to go before the king because he has just signed an order for the destruction of the Jewish people. Esther says, but I can't go before the king without permission. I get my head chopped off.
Head schmed, you go now, girl.
So Esther does. She gets brave. Spirit gets a hold of her, like Spirit always has. Gets a hold of her and sends her into the king.
Hello, darling. What may I offer you?
Well, your great highness, majestiness, your honorariumness, your principality, come to dinner. Well, she chickens out the first couple of times, and she brings him to dinner, winds him and dines him. Finally, I think about the third time, she finally tells him what Spirit has directed her to tell him, that he signed an order for the destruction of the Jewish people, and he is remorseful, he is sorry, and he raises an army to save the Jewish people. Now, the Jews have this wonderful festival called Purim, where they celebrate Esther, who spoke out. Wouldn't it be great if we had a big party where we would dance and sing and have good food for a week to celebrate people who had the courage to speak out for the right? Say amen.
Amen.
Okay, you guys plan it and I'll come. So, we're going to sing about this. And you're going to help me. I'm going to sing a line, and you're going to sing a line. The line I'm going to sing is, some people live in the chains of oppression and they never seem to get free. Your response is, uh-huh. I'll sing, some people act like they own the world and they supply the property. You say, oh yeah. And then I'll sing, who's going to stand and tell about freedom, about the way that they should be? Your answer is, that's us. And then I'll sing, later on I'll sing, I can dance for a week, you say, dance, dance. I can sing for a year, sing, sing. So it's uh-huh, oh yeah, that's us. Dance, dance, sing, sing, okay? You can do it. Here we go. Some people live.
Thank you.
you get to help write the songs. Most people in this room have got a story about a time when your church family came through for you. I told some of the choir folks the other day, when I was in graduate school, after graduate school was over, my wife and I were moving from Michigan to New Jersey, and some of our friends had said, "Oh, we'll help you move." So some of the church folks and the choir folks came, and they got us a U-Haul, and they loaded it up for us, and one couple was going to drive us all the way from Michigan to New Jersey, drive the U-Haul. The day before we were supposed to leave, they both got a roaring, raging case of the flu. I mean, the kind of flu where you are just down, 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 down. You can hardly move. With roaring flu, they got up, drove the U-Haul from Michigan to New Jersey, 750 miles, spent 3 days in a cheap hotel helping us find an apartment, loaded the furniture into the apartment, left and drove back to Michigan in the U-Haul, and probably collapsed. Now, that's your church family coming through for you. And many of us have had those kinds of experiences. And since the whole day seems to be focused today on welcome to the family, and how broad and the family is, and how Spirit brings us together, I would like for us to be telling stories about times when the church family came through. So here's the way it's going to work. We have a storytelling microphone. And some of the choir folks are kind of somewhat familiar because we've been telling stories all weekend. We have a storytelling mic, and in a minute, you're just going to get out of your seat. You're going to go to that mic, and we're going to clap for you like you're a big star. Like you're the king or queen of all storytellers. And you're going to tell me a story about a time when your church family came through for you, and then I will do my best to sing your story back to you. So, let me set it up with a little bit of an introduction. Okay, Catholics.
And that goes on still today. standing in the hall. I'm leaning on
Oh. Think of that bad concert on the best of all day.
when Spirit gets a hold of us, Spirit changes everything. The way we live, the way we spend our time, the way we make friends, and the way we care for our city. We're going to sing a final song. And before we sing our final song, I just want to say how wonderful it has been to be here this weekend. I want to say how fabulously you've been treated. You all have cared for us, you have welcomed us, you have treated us like royalty. I am so blown away by the way you have cared and loved us. This church is a wonder. There is love here, there is energy here, there is compassion here, there is caring here. I've just gotten a bit of a taste of some of the things that you guys are doing in the city, and I'm just blown away. And I want to say to you, I am honored that we got to be a part of you this weekend. And I hope that you continue in the way that you are, because what you are doing and who you are becoming is truly a work of the Holy Spirit. I'm absolutely convinced of that. We're going to sing a final song. Before we do, I want to mention the CDs. There are some CDs out in the back, and we're going to lock your doors until you buy them. There's a CD out there called Easter. Everybody always puts out Christmas CDs, but Lord, we are Easter people, yes? So, we don't have it. You can order it. There's a CD out there called Songs for the Pastor's Soul. Not just for pastors, but for anybody who's involved in ministry. If you ever get burned out, this CD is for you. The Moses piece you heard this morning is on that CD. Lots of stuff about encouraging, about staying with the path. One of my friends says it takes you all the way from I can't bear to get do this job one more day to, well, one more. There's a CD called Sea Change. It's songs all about the changes in our lives, all about discovering new directions for our lives. There's this whole song about being married for years and years and years and how one learns to love in spite of all the difficulties that crop up. There's a song about baptism called Sea Change. There's a song about reconciliation of a father and a son called Down Where the Willows Weep. There's another CD called Songs for the Hopeful Heart. It's got the brethren we have met to worship on it. And it's got the song about face-to-face that Beverly and I sang together. There's a children's CD called Kids Play. There's lots of things out there to look at. And I hope you'll take a look at those CDs. If you buy two titles, you get a third title free. Such a deal we have for you. My current favorite is a double CD. It's called That's How I See It Now. I've taken old Medena songs from 40 years ago, and I've given them a new dress and re-recorded them with voice and piano, and I'm just really pleased. So all those things are there for you to see. Now, let's sing our final song. Let me show you how this song goes. It's one that I hope you will use over and over again. You know the word shalom, this wonderful Hebrew word that means much more than just peace. It means the condition where all things are right, a condition where justice reigns, a condition where justice rolls down like water and righteousness like a flowing stream. Shalom is that condition where things are fair, where things are right, where all men and women are taken care of. And so we want to make a prayer about bringing shalom to our city.